Welcome to the Feel Free Again podcast. I'm your host, Cole James, and we are thrilled to have you here today. I am joined today by a dear friend of mine, a colleague, the vice president of the Grief Recovery Institute, and I met him in a really pretty interesting way, and you're going to hear about that today. And after I met this man, I instantly liked him, and he got these tools and he immediately started helping other people. And I just saw really the character of who this man was and what he was about. And I'm now privileged to be a colleague of his, and we get to work together every day. And I'll be forever grateful for that. So without any further ado, I want to welcome you, Ed Owens, to the podcast.
Yeah, I'm thrilled to be here. Good. I really am.
You know, we have a lot to talk about, and we're probably going to do a two-parter here because I think we're going to cover a lot of ground. But if you don't mind, why don't we get started with really what happened in your life, you know, for you to want to seek out something like the grief recovery method?
Sure. Absolutely. It's a great place to start. Like most of us moving through life, we're taught a whole lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And I was taught ways of navigating losses in my life or challenging things or changes or all these other things. And throughout my life and then my careers, you know, I thought I had it figured out, right? And I'd experienced at different points in my life a lot of different very painful things, but I always seemed to figure out how to get through it, right? How to manage it, how to survive it, whatever it was. And that all worked for me until it didn't work anymore.
Yeah.
And for most of my life, emotions were painful and I didn't want to deal with them. So I got really good at compartmentalization. I got really good at separating my feelings from what I had to do, be mission focused or whatever, those types of things. To varying degrees, you know, that worked.
Yeah.
I wasn't thriving, but you know, I could navigate it. Right. Until the death of my 3.5-year-old son, Eddie Ryan. And I found myself in that moment, everything crumbled away. Like nothing. It was like trying to reach for something, things that had always worked, you know, and none of it worked.
Right.
I always tell people like I found myself in this really dark place. All I could feel was like I was drowning in a sea of pain.
Would you kind of give us a little bit of picture of when you lost him? Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, what you were doing for work? Where were you at, like, in your part of your life? Like, would you mind just telling us a little bit more about that?
Sure. So at the time, I was a law enforcement officer. I wore a shield for 23 years. And at that point in my career, I was an intelligence detective.
Okay.
So I did a lot of investigations and, you know, kind of worked that world that week. I was working a case. We were working super long days, like 14, 15-hour days type of a situation. You know, I don't know if you want me to talk about like the events of that night or like some of the things that were contributed to that night, but you know, that night would forever change my life because I was up late and I was exhausted. There was a whole lot of things that were going on. Like most of us, when those events happen, there's a lot of details in those nights you're never going to forget.
Right.
A lot of things happen in those nights that you see that are traumatizing or are impacting. But what I can tell you from that night is I was up late. My son had been up. He was spoiled rotten. He still slept in our bed.
Yeah.
Right? And he was my firstborn son.
Yeah.
We're up late and he's up. Right?
Yeah.
And for whatever reason that night, normally when he would get up, I'd call him down to me. Right? I'd lift him over the gate for the stairs.
Yep.
And then I'd finish up whatever we were doing. We'd go to bed and we'd take him with us. You know, that night I didn't. Hmm. That night I just told Ryan, go back to bed. And he said, yes, Daddy. And he went into the room. And a few minutes later, there was this really loud pop. And I didn't know what it was at first. And I soon would find out what it was. And at first I didn't realize why this was going on. I was trying to turn on lights. There was a whole lot of things going on. Again, all those details are not as important as what it felt like in that moment. And I was gripped with sheer panic and terror. And I couldn't understand what was going on because, you know, I know from my training, I got tunnel vision. And I was super focused on trying to figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
And why is my son hurt? And when the lights came on, I saw that the door to the gun box was wide open. And then I knew what the pop was. And then I saw my my backup gun laying next to my son. I couldn't see it before, you know? And then I kind of kicked into automatic mode.
Yeah.
Thankfully, my training kicked in. I was on the phone with 911. I was coordinating everything. And then it became a blur. And for 4 hours, he fought for his life. Surgeons came in, and I'm sorry, but your son, he died. Was like, it's like someone center punched my chest and ripped my heart out. And I was in this space where, like, I had all the feelings, right? Yeah. I was devastated. I was crushed. I was internalizing feelings like, this is my fault. Like, I, as a man, right? We're supposed to protect our kids. And I'm like, I'm the worst dad in the world. Mm-hmm. I failed to keep my son safe. My job is to protect him. My job was involved in this whole deal. Mm-hmm. And so I had these misplaced feelings of guilt and responsibility. And that really, you know, magnified that experience for me.
Yeah, I can't even imagine, you know. And you know that I love you very much.
I do.
And, you know, for those of you that are watching this, you're going to hear about this later in the story. But this is a story I know, and we've hugged each other a lot over this story. For most of you watching this or listening to this, this may be the first time that you've heard this story. And it is tragic, you know, and I wish we could have met under any other circumstances than we did. I'm glad we did meet. Mm-hmm. For right now, thank you for telling the truth about that. I can't imagine, like you said, there are so many layers to this story, your profession, you being a father, you being a protector, this accident happening, you know, and all those things. So if you don't mind, Ed, if you can kind of walk us through a little bit of the aftermath and the, mm-hmm. I know just from what we do and what I've been through in my life, and again, not comparing any of my losses to your losses, because we don't do that, any of that kind of stuff in this work. But I'd imagine that there was a time where probably you were just absolutely out of the moment quite a bit. And there was not there, you know, we're not starting our journey of healing right away, right? We're absolutely just surviving and, you know, so if you want to start there and then kind of walk us through, you know, what you're healing and where that took you.
Yeah. Those initial days and weeks, were a blur. I mean, there's no doubt about that. It was a complete overwhelmed in every way.
Yeah.
And again, we're not going to get into all of the things that were transpiring, but it was, you know, it was chaos. Most painful experience of my life. Right. And starting to come out of that fog, starting to come and deal with this after the just flooding of emotions and the flooding of events. I got bombarded with a lot of things. People were well-meaning, loving people were saying a lot of things to me to try to be helpful. And it wasn't very helpful at all whatsoever. So I found myself like isolating from people. And at the same time, I'm also like trying to take care of, you know, my wife. I'm trying to take care of my other kids. And I felt like I couldn't be fully present for them, which that just added to the problems that I was feeling, like I wasn't able to do that. And people started coming to me, whether it was the department offering counseling or, you know, they offered me medications. I started antidepressants and stuff. I took them. I didn't like them.
Yeah.
I stopped after about a week because I didn't feel good on them. I went to counseling. I went 3 times a week. I mean, I was doing like, hey, Ed, you need to do this. Okay. None of it was really helping me to deal with it. And then there's all the aftermath of all of that.
I'm sorry to interrupt. In this time frame, when things were bubbling up for you, you know, when memories were happening, when this pain was happening, was it, if you don't mind, just because I think a lot of people listening to this will be able to relate, you know, and one of our biggest things that we do, the work we do, is we just want everyone to know that none of us are alone in this stuff. But when we're in it, we feel like that. So, you know, part of our goal is just to identify, hey, we're all in this together, ultimately, right? And I don't know how you feel and you don't know how I feel, but like we can at least connect on some of these pain points and hurt. So did the hurt come at night when you were alone? Did it come throughout the day? Was it constant?
In those initial weeks, it was constant. You know, I didn't sleep for 3 days or more until I was so physically exhausted I passed out. You know, I couldn't eat anything without becoming physically ill. You know, it was all of that that was going on, not being able to focus, you know, drifting off and into space. Like, I'm constantly reviewing that relationship. I was constantly reviewing every aspect of what happened, you know, all the things I wish were better, different. And trust me, that was a huge list of what I wish I could change.
Right.
And that's, I got stuck in like this loop, and it did affect my sleep. It did affect my eating. It affected my, how I could interact.
Yeah.
You become super laser focused. On that loss, like, yeah. I was focused on Ryan. Yeah. And like I mentioned, like with my wife and other kids, like, I couldn't even be there for them. I couldn't be there for myself.
Sure. Yeah.
And that just added to it as well.
Hmm. It's, you mentioned a couple of things there that I just want to key in on for a second, which is you felt like you were in a loop, right? Mm-hmm. And that's something that we talk about all the time. Mm-hmm. Is for those of you that are younger, there used to be these things called records, right? And there were, there was a record player, and it would spin round and round, mm-hmm. right? And one of the ways that the pioneers of this work put it way back in the day in the 70s and 80s when we were doing this work, you know, and pretty much the only people helping grievers at that time, quite honestly, specifically around grief and loss, you know, they would use this reference around a record player, and the needle falls off, but we're still spinning, and mm-hmm. we're just in a loop, and we don't know what to do with these reoccurring memories and these reoccurring feelings just mm-hmm. over and over and over. So I just wanted to touch on that, because that's a very common thing for a lot of us when we do have grief and loss in our lives. Unresolved grief, of big indicator of that is just the constant mm-hmm. replaying, right? So anyway, I didn't mean to interrupt, but
no, you're all good. And that's what it felt like. And even if I, you know, sometimes I describe it as like drowning, and when you fight your way back to where you can get an air, you're getting sucked back under again. And that was like, that's what it felt like. It was just this constant cycle of pain, regret, feelings of guilt, you know, misplaced feelings of guilt, all these other things. And it was just, it was intense. The whole of my life, I never felt that level of intensity. You know, and then there's all types of other stuff that was going on at the same time. I also, through the mix of this, would get flooded with other things in my life that were in the moment. Yeah. Like, why is this popping up in this? And so it felt like I was getting crushed a lot of times.
Yep.
And it didn't feel good, right? Yep. It hurt. I felt there must have been something wrong with me. Like, why can't I, you know, be strong for my kids? Or why can't I feel like how to man up on this? And so, and I couldn't.
Yeah.
And I literally, like, people are talking to me and I'm trying to figure stuff out. And I started hearing this message really early on. And it never felt right to me. People would tell me, my God, to lose a child is the worst thing in the world. And absolutely, there's a lot of truth that, you know, as a parent, we should outlive our children, or our children should outlive us. And, you know, it's this life sentence of pain. I mean, they even talked about that at the memorial, figuring out what's your new normal. Like, you know, the example of a veteran coming home who's lost his leg, has to learn how to move through life without that. And none of this stuff, I mean, it pissed me off.
Gotcha. So intuitively inside, right, you are feeling crushed. You are devastated beyond belief,
mm-hmm.
right? But still inside of you, when you have other people saying this is a life sentence of misery, there's never kind of, you know, what I'm hearing, and correct me if I'm wrong, but what I'm hearing you say is even through all of this pain and being crushed, there's still something inside of you that's like, I can't live this way forever.
Right.
This can't be my life sentence of misery. Okay.
Exactly.
Gotcha. Okay.
You know, and I wasn't willing to accept that explanation, right? One, it didn't feel right, you know, and two, it's like, that can't be true.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
Right? There has to be a way to deal with this pain. I can't, you know, what I desperately wanted back, I knew intellectually, I can't have back. My heart wanted it back. But there had to be a way to reconcile those two things. Right? And the more I kept hearing these things, the more I'm like, that's not true. It can't be true. I don't believe it's true. I kind of stumbled around for like 5 years, right? I literally tried everything. I mean, I went to seminars. I, you know, talked to counselors. I talked to religious leaders. I mean, I'm not proud of the fact that I got really heavy into drinking, right? I got really heavy into doing things to try and numb the pain. I mean, there was a long period of time where the only way I was getting to sleep is if I had a few drinks.
Sure, sure.
Because in the darkness, in those quiet moments, those images came rushing back, and I just needed to get some sleep. I couldn't live with some of those images. And they drove so many of my decisions in life, but they also drove my desire to try and deal with it. Someone suggested this, I'd try it. Nope, not getting to the heart of the matter. If someone would suggest this, I go, nope, that was nice. And then what I found over time, over those 5 years, even when I found myself having a moment where I started to feel normal, then I'd beat the shit out of myself. Excuse my language. Why should I feel anything? Like, I don't deserve, like, I was still beating myself up and holding myself accountable mm-hmm. for all this whole thing. Like, why didn't I prevent this? Fast forward over those 5 years, it was just this cycle where my life was spinning out of control. Relationships were spinning out of control. Friends, family, everything, it changed the dynamics.
Sure, right? Because it's like you're grieving massively. You're bleeding to death emotionally. Mm-hmm. And so is your wife at the time.
Yep.
And so is your family.
Yep.
And all your folks and her folks. And we're all grieving, mm-hmm. right? And again, one of the major issues in this scenario is none of us had any tools or were taught any tools growing up around this.
Correct.
Right? And, you know, add to the fact, you know, Ed got into this a little bit, but it's like long-term combat veteran, long-term law enforcement guy, mm-hmm. problem solver guy, mm-hmm. right? Probably not skewing as much on the emotionally available at that time in your life, guy. And again, if anyone endures this loss, it doesn't matter how emotionally in touch you are. We're all going to just be absolutely mm-hmm. devastated. Right. But you hadn't picked these tools up, emotional tools, probably along the way yet.
No. And, you know, whether it's at the academy or when they talked about how to deal with these things, it really was learn how to compartmentalize it. Learn how to do other things to try and replace it. Like you just need to exercise more. I'm not saying these aren't good things, like a healthy exercise routine, eating healthy, all those things are great, but none of the things they taught you at the academy or that they taught you in the service had any type of a significant impact on it. Right. Yep. So I didn't have any training or information or people around me who that's what they all knew to give me something solid.
Yeah.
Right. And then, so again, like I'm trying to find that piece. It's like, you know, what's that missing puzzle piece?
Yeah. 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 And we're going to get into this more, I think, in later in our talk, right? But compartmentalizing.
Yep.
Right. It's like, again, in a lot of people's roles, we work with the military a lot. We work in law enforcement. And mm-hmm. look, if you're on a mission, if you're on target, or if you're serving a warrant or something, you have to compartmentalize, right? That is not the place to do anything other than be in the moment, for sure. The problem is though, right? We can only compartmentalize for so long, and then we have to go to the alcohol, or to something else, right?
Yep, exactly.
And that's the roadmap for a lot of us, right?
It is.
And especially you guys in the first responder category, in the law enforcement category, like you guys are an extreme of that, right? And for good reason. You know, the thing that is, I know, breaks your heart and breaks my heart too, and is the suicide rate. And you know, what we would say is that's compartmentalizing mm-hmm. and life gets in the way more and more and more, and the fire builds and your tea kettle mm-hmm. cannot hold anymore. Mm-hmm. And the pressure doesn't stop, right? Life keeps going and loss mm-hmm. and pain keeps coming.
Absolutely.
And the alcohol doesn't work like it did before, you know, whatever the case is for me or you and that mm-hmm. truth. But it's like the suicide rate, like all of these things there's a huge component around unresolved trauma and pain and grief and loss, whatever you want to call it, whatever Correct. The word du jour is of this, you know, decade, right? Because last decade, it was something else. It's trauma now. You know, at some point we hope that grief, that term is also in there because it is massively what a lot of us are dealing with, you know?
Absolutely.
But I just wanted to clarify that for the audience a little bit. Just again, your background and kind of your skill set from before, but we can't just solve this. We can't just fix this from the skill set you had from before.
Right, yeah. Exactly. I never got to that point. I mean, there were times I was like, I don't know how I'm going to get through the rest of my life with this. Like this, I can't live my life this way, which for me, I didn't go to, if I can't figure out how to fix this, I'm going to end my life. Mm-hmm. I never got to that point
yep.
because I believe somewhere there had to be a different answer yep. and a different option. And I'd lost friends to suicide, whether it was the military, you know, I'd seen how that can devastate families, how that can devastate. So like for me, that was not an option on the table. Yep. And I know that's an option for a lot of people. Sure. And they choose that option because everything else, they try it, doesn't work. They feel like I have no choice left.
Yep.
And my heart breaks for those folks because there is another choice. Again, that's we'll talk about all that stuff later on, like what we do. And I, if anyone's watching this, I mean, I hope you realize there are other options. If you find yourself in that position, realize there is no choice, right? And whether you're a bereaved parent or you're in the military or in law enforcement and you're just feeling like I'm at that point, there are other options. To lose a child is not a life sentence of pain. To deal with the things you see in the, in a military career, a law enforcement career, doesn't have to be your life sentence of pain. It doesn't have to become your identity. And that also bothered me because I got referred to as, you know, that's the dad who lost his son.
Mm.
And that was part of my experience, but I didn't want that to be my identity.
And that, and there's a lot of that in the grief community too.
Yeah.
And especially in for those that have lost a child, right? There is a push, and we don't agree with this, but there's a push for people to really have that be the identity.
Yeah.
And again, when we're unfinished, when we're on that record player loop and we don't know what else, and people come together with us and we're all sharing in this pain of the same type of a loss, I can see where people have that be their new identity, right? Mm-hmm. But it's interesting because we do, there's, I don't know what the percentage is, right? But we work with a lot, hundreds, thousands now of people who have lost a child,
yeah,
you know, in our work. And a lot of them have kind of it going on what you're talking about right now, right? Which is this push-pull of, I can't live this way forever. It doesn't feel right for people to propose that I'm going to live this way forever. Mm-hmm. And then if I forget about it or I forget about the pain for a little bit, I beat my shit out of myself for a little bit, right? So there's this push-pull between those two things.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And you hold on, you know, when you're in that circumstance, and it's not just being a bereaved parent. I mean, any... for many of my other losses have been true for me. Working with people, this is true. Like, we hold on to every little piece, right? Like, there's a feeling of desperation, right? I've lost so much that meant so much to me, and I'm going to hold on to every little thing, whether that's every little toy, whether that's every little memory, and we keep replaying them also in part because I can't forget. I can't forget. It's the only thing I got left is my memory. It's the only thing I got left is these physical things attached to that person. And, you know, I can get why some people might move down that road of like, they can't get rid of anything in their life. And that's a separate discussion, but that was true for me too. Like I don't have him. So I have to hold on to every little thing I can, every memory, every toy, every piece of clothing. I mean, and then you also can't look at it. Right. So it's this weird thing going on, right? Like, I can't let go of this because I don't want to forget him. And there's that sphere of forgetting, like, that's not possible. I'll tell you that, right? That's not possible.
Yeah.
But that's where I was.
Yeah. Yeah. I'd offer you a hug right now, but we got cameras going and mics going, and we've hugged a lot about this. But I just want to, number one, I just admire you so much, and I appreciate your courage to do this. And I know a big piece of this is to help others, you know, and because none of us like to go here. I mean, me and you fly around the country regularly talking about our deepest, darkest pains and heartaches and stuff like that. And we do it so that other people can see that there's a way, right? Yeah. Our job is to provide hope. So I want to just appreciate you being here and telling the truth like you are. If you don't mind, let's pivot to, okay, so we're 5 years in, we've tried everything.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't mind just walking us through, you know, the... How you kind of got led to this work, how we met, you know, that kind of stuff.
Sure. Trying to figure out what life was like, right? All of this is a constant struggle. It's an ever-present, like, elephant in the room that's another thing like nobody wants to talk about, right? I want to talk about Ryan, and it was nobody else wanted to talk about it. So there's a lot of different dynamics. But during that whole thing, when I'm trying to figure out life, and I'm trying to figure out how to what this looks like now, right? Because everything changed. Yeah. And I, trust me, everything changed. I went to a seminar, and it wasn't us. It wasn't the grief recovery method.
Yeah.
It was a different seminar because, again, I'm like trying. Yeah. I'm really trying to deal with this and to figure out life. And so I went to this one seminar, And you know, it was called Integrate. It was great.
Yep.
It was 5 days. It was intense. And anyway, I met someone there. Right. And, you know, my marriage fell apart. We separated, you know, that relationship broke, as a outcome, a side effect of losing Ryan. So I met this person, we became friends, we're getting to know each other. And she's like, have you ever heard of this thing called the grief recovery method? And I'm like, no. She goes, I'd like to introduce you to my mom. She is a grief recovery specialist. And funny story, she would be trained by Russell like 15 years earlier.
Wow.
And stuff. Like, that was the whole concept of this. And so I went to this lunch and we talked about stuff and I really liked what she had to say. And actually what she was talking about, like, really resonated with me. Like, just some of our basic things we know are true that we try to educate other people on.
Yeah.
But it was the first time I'd ever heard some of this stuff phrased. And I was like, there's something here. You know, and it wasn't like intellectually I thought there was something here. It's like I felt it.
Yeah.
Like, and then I got super hopeful, right? Like, maybe this is my puzzle piece I'm missing. I literally went home from that lunch, got on the internet, found the website, saw there was a class coming up, didn't read a single thing about anything, and I signed up. And not only did I sign up, I actually called. So Dawn, it's my partner. Mm-hmm. Like, we're together now. We've been together for years.
Yep.
And it was her mom. And so I called Dawn. I'm like, hey, this looks really interesting. I signed us both up. And she's like, well, no, that's for you. I don't have anything that I need to deal with. You know, that's for you. And I'm like, well, if I'm going and you introduce me to this, you're going too.
Yeah.
So we went, and lo and behold, I walk into this class. I have no idea what I'm getting into.
And let me real briefly paint the picture. Hotel conference room, kind of a semicircle of chairs, and a bunch of boxes of Kleenex on the ground, right?
Uh-huh.
And I can only imagine Ed, you know, you know, with your background and the warrior culture you come from, right? I can only imagine what went through your head when you walked in and that's what you saw, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm like, So, I guess that hopeful piece, right? Like, this all feels right. I don't know why. And I was skeptical.
Sure.
I was super skeptical. I mean, that's the cop side of me. That's the you know, military side of me. And everything else hadn't worked. So I'm willing to try this out of a place of I don't want to live that way anymore.
Mm.
Right? I can't live my life that way.
Yeah.
That's not my identity. Living with that pain. Like, I'm going to step into this. And it's not like, it wasn't like I lacked the courage to step into it. I'd stepped into a lot of things in my life, right? But it was from that place of hope mixed with intense skepticism.
Sure.
You know, and for all of you that are listening to this, you know, like when I walked into that room, he was there.
Yep. Unbeknownst to me, we have 10 kind of trainers that do what I do all across the world, where we do these 4-day, weekend certifications is what we call them. But really a big bulk of that weekend is deep personal work, right? Because we won't train someone to help someone else unless they're willing to go and learn the method and do the work on their heart fearlessly. And so, anyway, I just happened to be the trainer that weekend in Portland, and you were an attendee, and Don was an attendee in the class, and I don't know how many people we had, 12, maybe 10 or 12.
Oh, it's like 14 or 15 in that class. So, it was a good-sized class. Yeah,
good-sized class.
You know, and here's the thing, like, I had no intention of ever being a specialist.
Right, yeah. You were there for the personal work.
Right, deal.
And that's another dynamic real quick, you know, just in case you've never heard of us or what we do, right? Some people come to that 4-day and they're more on the personal work side, and really the goal and priority is to do their own personal work. And then we got to, you know, encourage them and train them how to help others, because that's maybe a little piece of it for people, or there's no intention at all. And then on the other side, there's people there that are the professionals, and we have to convince them they're also grievers and they also have massive significant losses from their past, and we want to help them with those too. Because then they're going to be more effective as a professional, you know, helping other people. So there's kind of a really cool mixture of people there for different reasons or different priorities. And that all kind of goes away pretty quickly once we get into the work. But anyway, go ahead.
Yeah. So in hindsight, I'm using a personal workup. Yeah. I created my own private investigations company. I had a job.
Yeah.
I wasn't looking for a job.
I had you pegged for a cop the minute I walked in, by the way.
You asked me once on a break.
Oh, did I? Okay, I'm pretty good with profiling.
Yeah.
And I've worked with a lot of people, and I have that kind of skill set. But I was pretty sure you were a cop.
And we've talked about this before, but, you know, for the listeners, I was not easy on this man during the class. You know, again, it was that I'm hopeful and I'm skeptical. You know, you need to prove this to me.
Yeah.
And at one point in the weekend, and it's one of the things I'm forever grateful for you in my life. At one point in the weekend, I got scared.
Sure.
And I got up to leave. And I was like, I can't do this. And there's very few things in my life I've ever walked away from or it was in that position. But at that moment, I was scared to death to have to sit there and take an honest look at the most painful thing in my life and choose. It's a choice, right? And in that moment, I was so scared, I didn't know if I could make the choice, you know? And you had a conversation with me in the hallway. You know, we connected, right, in a way that I felt, you know, I can do this. This is safe enough. Cole's safe enough for me to do this. I'm going to trust him. I'm going to trust the process, even though I'm scared to death.
Yeah.
And I walk back into that room, and I don't regret. That's one of the best decisions I ever made in my life.
I am so grateful that we got to meet and I got to help kind of lead that group. You know, I'll be forever grateful that I, you know, and that's not taking anything away from the other instructors, but I think it was meant to be that you and I were in that room together. And, you know, one of the things that's so, and pieces of this have dawned on me, but we've been working together for years, and this kind of just dawned on me today in right here, real time in this podcast. You know, one of the things I'm drawn to you just as a friend and kind of like a big brother to me or a mentor to me, you know, in a lot of ways, is you and my dad have a lot, you've shared a lot in your life, like in terms of coming to this work, right? Both combat veterans, both very much men who have their priority to help their crew, their clan, their people, their family, whatever you want to call it, but like integrity and really a desire to serve, you know, and both the loss of a young child.
Yeah.
Right. And desperately in pain and also wanting tools to heal from that.
Yeah.
Right. And I've never seen it so clearly as right now, just the similar path you guys have walked, you know, in terms of taking this tragic thing that happened that you would have never wanted, right? And still continuing to help and serve people even after this tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so yeah, you're just an incredible guy.
I appreciate that. And I feel the same about you. And I feel the same about John.
Yeah.
You know, I got to meet him that weekend. You know?
And that was also not a coincidence in my book. To me, you know, and with my belief system, that was God, you know, and he put you two there. Yeah. So you could have further reassurance, you know, that this was the right place for you to be.
Yeah. And that was like this, I agree. I don't believe there's coincidence. I think things coincide when we are open to the experience.
Yeah. And let me just say this real quick, little advertisement for this work, because you'll get those periodically in this podcast. We're trying to go light on it and really just, you know, connect with people wherever you're at. You know, you may be in that first 5 years and you've tried everything and maybe this is something you should try. You may be in the first 3 months where literally just getting out of bed and getting something to eat is the goal, right? And we got room and we got space for you no matter what. The thing that I'll say that I love about this work, and I think you'll vouch for this, if you're a yoga instructor in Santa Monica, California, this work is what you make of it, and this work can feel very right for you and fit very well with what you're doing. And if you're a military veteran male and you have come from a very kind of warrior culture, this work can also be very, very beneficial to
you.
So, you know, because some programs are very kind of like spiritual or woo-woo or hardcore and intense or, you know, whatever. And I have not seen someone who's who wants to be a willing participant and wants to take the actions to heal from their loss not be able to benefit from this?
Absolutely.
And we don't really put in a bunch of like superfluous stuff that's like will get in the way of who you are, Ed, or who that yoga instructor is in right. Santa Monica, or you know, and I love that. And again, male, female, any religion, not religion, any culture, any color, any political bent. It's like, if you come here to work on your pain and your hurt, we're going to welcome you. We're going to have a seat right here for you. And then we're going to help you utilize these tools to help you, right? It's not me. I didn't do anything in that weekend for you other than hopefully articulate these tools so you could apply them. And again, my goal when you got scared was just for you to trust me that I was going to just help you through it and be a safe place, you know? But other than that, it was all you, and you know that.
And now I know I'm the one that did all the heavy lifting. Yep. And, you know, I want to piggyback on what you were saying there too. I would give almost anything that if I'd have been introduced to this 4 years and 10 months earlier. Seriously. I really do. Yeah. I mean, I spent so much time in a dark, painful place and dark, painful experience in life, I wouldn't have had to spend those years in that place, you know? And that's not a fault of anyone around me. That's not a fault of myself not knowing or anything else. It's just we do the best we can with the tools we're taught until we learn new tools, right?
Yep.
And I just wish I'd have had the chance. And so part of the reason why we're doing this conversation and part of the things we do you know, is to get people at least plant the seed, like, hey, there is something you can do. You know, you don't have to wait a year after a loss before you can deal with something. In fact, your clearest picture is right after it. So, you know, I just want to piggyback on that.
Well, and that's, thank you for saying that. And with a story as powerful as yours, I'm glad you're saying it, right? Because it needs to be said. What happens in society is that if you have the loss, right, and you want to go do work around it, people will say it's too soon.
Yeah.
Right? And then you go, okay. And then the next thing they'll say is time's going to heal it, you know, in some other conversation. So then you wait,
mm-hmm.
right? And then at some point, right, let's say 5 years or 2 years or 4 years, maybe we get really good at alcohol. Maybe we just, you know, the memories fade a little bit, the intensity fades a little bit, or we've just convinced ourselves this is our new normal, mm-hmm. right? And then the window is gone, right? Because people told me it's too soon, don't do any work. And then later they say, but don't worry, time will heal it. But we don't know what to do within that timeline. So then at some point we just declare time has healed it. Mm-hmm. When really we're just a shell of our former ourselves, you know, and maybe we're just kind of, now this is our new identity, which is just pain and hurt, and my new identity mm-hmm. is the guy that son died, like you were saying, like some of the other people on the force were, you know, that was your new identity. And
yeah,
and I'm so glad that you cut through all of that and you kept searching.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, it was one of the best things. Making the decision to go through this was one of the best things I've ever done in my life. Deciding to stay and finish it was one of those moments that is a seminal moment in my life. Just as much as losing him, you know, going through this and, you know, we don't compare, right? But one of the things like I learned coming out of that, and I know we've talked about this before and I've shared this before, and it really speaks to how powerful this experience has been for me in my life, why I want to help other people. I don't want to see people suffering for a year or 5 years or 10 years because it's not a life sentence of pain. What I realized coming out of that was Ryan taught me more about life and death after going through this experience with the method than I would have ever taught him as a dad. Mm. And just that allows his presence in my life to be the gift that it's supposed to be. Our children are supposed to be a gift, and they are a gift. And the pain got in my way. And what I desperately wanted was to feel that love, to feel that joy, to feel that connection. Yeah. And having to go through this, and it's not easy. You know it's not easy. I know it's not easy. If you're watching, this is not easy. We're not going to tell you it's easy. But the outcome is worth it. To be able to feel that connection, to be able to cherish the gift that person or other relationship in your life, or it's a pet, or whatever, that has value, and that's what gives life meaning. And when we're hurting and we can't access that, right, it diminishes our capacity to feel love and joy again.
Yeah.
And I walked out of that weekend with a heart filled with joy. I wasn't sure how long it would last.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, God, I can feel this again. Like, I, you know, as crazy as it sounds, I could feel the connection with my son that I desperately wanted to feel, but I was, all this shit getting in my way.
Yeah. And it doesn't sound crazy at all, you know, because we get that feedback a lot, right?
Mm-hmm.
What this allows us to do is when we can say goodbye to the pain,
mm-hmm.
not Ryan, we could mm-hmm. say goodbye to the pain, then we can open the door to our emotional relationship that we have,
yeah.
right? And we can find the happy mm-hmm. stuff, right? And the joy. We can also find the sadness,
yeah.
but the sadness is different than the pain, right? And that's really
it
the
is.
Goal of what we do is help people say goodbye to the pain so that we can have more room for the happiness, for the joy.
Yeah.
And if you're not there right now, if me even saying this makes you angry, that's okay too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've done this for a long time and we've worked with a lot of people. And so I'm comfortable with wherever people are,
mm-hmm.
right? I think the takeaway is, and I know since becoming a trainer, because, you know, what I did for you in that 4 days, which was lead mm-hmm. you through it, you know, Ed became an incredible trainer doing this. So I know you've helped people not mm-hmm. leave the room. I know you've seen people who were, you know, steam coming out of their ears because mm-hmm. you proposed that they could live a very deep, fulfilling life, even in spite of this, mm-hmm. these things that happened to us, right? Thank you for sharing your truth and for sharing your story, you know, and again, at the end, also sharing you getting to the other side of this,
yeah.
right? One of the things that we haven't mentioned yet, and I hope you're okay with me mentioning
yeah.
it, but like I met you at year 5,
mm-hmm.
and I saw you at year 6, and I saw you at year 7, and by that mm-hmm. time, we're working together in the office
yeah.
together, right? And so I watched you go through anniversaries.
Yeah.
I watched you, you shared with things that you didn't yeah. want to get rid of. From mm-hmm. Eddie Ryan and share those things with me.
Mm-hmm.
And I've watched this process. And, you know, one of the gifts, again, just for me as a friend and an outsider looking in, is you have this tremendous, amazing young man that's your other son.
Yeah.
And I got to watch you show up as one of the best dads I've ever seen. And you have this, incredible partner in Dawn. And I've watched you guys, you know, just be so tight together and be so loyal to each other, you know, and travel and do all of these things that you guys want to do together.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm so glad that you were present and had the capacity to be those things to those people and many others. I mean, your family and how you show up for your family and your parents, and it's nothing short of remarkable. And for me, like, the gift was you had the capacity to be all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the work you did.
Absolutely.
You know, and I know that the things that keep me and you up at night is the fact that a lot of people at year 5 or year 2 convince themselves that time has healed it
mm-hmm.
and they just live the rest of their lives a shell of themselves.
Absolutely.
Now, that's tragic in and of itself. That's tragic. But do you know what else is tragic? Is the countless sons and daughters of those people.
Mm-hmm.
Who have become adults. And when they come to do their trauma work, their grief work, their pain work around the past, their pain, and maybe still, is them grieving the father that was never there for them in life. Although
right.
he was alive, he was a shell of himself because one of their siblings had died.
Right.
And that mom or that dad never recovered. And now this living adult child, you know, who was a child, now living adult, is grieving their living parent
mm-hmm.
who could never have shown up for them after that
yeah.
loss. And I'm so glad that that was not you, because you kept searching and you found something, you know, that helped.
It was. And
yeah.
there's a lot of additional benefits to this experience we call the method, and how it can change your life, how it changed my life. And what you bring up there is, you know, when, remember when I was talking about what it was like in those initial days, weeks, months, and I couldn't be there for my kids. I couldn't be there for my wife at the time. I couldn't be there for other people, right? I couldn't be there for myself. So I had to heal me first so I could experience that benefit of being there for others, right? I realized very quickly what's important in my life, right? How do I want to show up? And more importantly, I have to have the ability to show up and be fully in the present moment. I'm not perfect, right? Yep. None of us are. But I do try to show up in the lives of the people who matter to me, mm-hmm. whether that's my kids, whether that's my parents, you, anyone else, or the people we get to work with. I'm a better partner than I ever was in either of my first two marriages. I'm a better dad than I ever was. Again, Ryan taught me more with his life and death than I would have ever taught him. Mm. And I try to show up every day for my kids that way, right? And I try and show up for the other people in my life that way. It's made me a better part, like I said, partner, parent, friend, coworker, you know, citizen of my community, you know, and that feels good to show up fully, to be fully present for someone else, you know, and live life that way. And I had a lot of regrets from that period of time after Ryan died. And I've gone back to both of my kids, you know, and I've sat there and had those conversations. You know, those were some of my deepest regrets with them. And I've made sure we've dealt with that as a family and moving forward, you know. And again, they're not going to have that experience of that dad or that mom who, for no fault of their own, just can't show up fully and presently because the pain is like an anchor weighing them down. Right? It doesn't weigh me down. And I get to be there that way. And it's a great feeling.
You know, you live this stuff. You're an example of this stuff. You know, I know your daughter's been through this work.
She has.
You know, I know your partner's been through this work. And, you know, and for me, I'm grateful that Ashley, my wife, has been through this work, you know, and my sister's been through this work. And my mom's been through this work. And, and it's a beauty to be on the same sheet of music. Multiple people in a family.
Yeah.
You have this shorthand communication emotionally with people that unfortunately most families don't get an opportunity to have, right? Yeah. And we learn these really important skills on how to actually apply forgiveness and how to properly apologize for when we mess up and how to also just give significant emotional statements regularly.
And that's key.
Yeah.
That one right there is key. I make sure that every person who's in my life that has value to me knows how much I love them, what I appreciate about them, what I value about them, that they're important, you know, and tomorrow's not promised. You know, it is, isn't, but I don't want them to have a regret. Like they didn't have a chance to have those conversations with me or they never heard me say this. That is never a consideration. Now, am I sure I've missed a few things? Yeah, absolutely, I'm human. But I will tell you, at least in my close inner circle, I try to live fully present in a way that, you know, I'm not building regrets on my side or their side. And I got two great kids, and I'll be more than happy to brag about Lindsay and Bradley all day long. And they're very heart-centered people. And stuff. In large part, that's something else. Like being around this for as long as I have, is they've got to see how it impacted me, and we have talked about that in the family, and they've got to experience it in their own lives, and it's made their lives more robust. It's made our relationships so close.
Well, Ed, you know, again, I just want to thank you for being here. We are going to wrap part one. Please stay tuned. We're going to have part two coming. And again, it's another really important piece of your story. And we're going to really get into kind of one of Ed's really passion groups on who he wants to help with the grief recovery method. So stay tuned for part two. We'll be bringing it here to you shortly. Thank you.